Christian Church is present in all nations of all continents of the planet. Churches and countries of the three Americas, Europe, Africa, Asia, and Oceania, connected by the same doctrine, by the direction of the Holy Spirit of God, and united by the living Word. Parts of the world participate in the same service, in conjunction, in the same body, and in the same spirit. Through the system of transmission, the members of the Maranatha Christian Church all around the globe live a moment of unity and fellowship, as the Hebrews lived in exiling Egypt, and as the disciples with the Lord Jesus before his death on the cross of Calvary. People from all parts of the world have been reached by the everlasting gospel and by the message of the soon return of the Lord Jesus.
Of the Lord Jesus. This is another episode of the program Announcing the Eternal Gospel by the Maranatha Christian Church. You are very welcome in this program that is made for you and your family. In today's edition, in the sketch of Lessons of Manaim, Pastors Daniel Moreira and Sergio Souza will conclude the story of Joseph. In the sketch Perfect Praise, we will continue to learn how to play melodica with the teacher Janaína Zumaki. Also in the class for the children, intermediates, and adolescents, teacher Andrea Talma will talk about the encounter of Joseph with his brothers. And today, we will get to know another Manaim in Brazil. This time, we will get to know the Manaim in Vale do Aço. This Manaim is located in a rural area that was acquired in 2002. It is surrounded by dense vegetation of eucalyptus and spans an area of about 304 acres. With a constructed area of 7,200 meters squared, the Manaim Vale do Aço is located in the town of Timóteo, 200 kilometers away from Belo Horizonte, bridging the cities of Ipatinga and Coronel Fabriciano. In 2008, it was inaugurated, and it is capable of hosting 1,200 people in the events and seminars. After the images showing the Manaim of Vale do Aço, you're invited to watch the sketch Lessons of Manaim. Fraternal embrace to the churches in Vale do Aço. Glory to God. This is the sketch Lessons of Manaim. May God bless us with the peace of the Lord Jesus. Pastor Sergio, peace of the Lord Jesus. Peace of the Lord Jesus, Pastor Daniel. We are very happy to have your audience. God has a special blessing prepared for your life. Would like to inform you who are watching us that by accessing the Maranatha Christian Church's website, you will find a web page of the program Announcing the Eternal Gospel. Through this page, you can send us a message, a suggestion, or even a testimony. Last week, we presented another part of Joseph's story. And today, we will conclude this story with a special emphasis on the aspect of salvation. In other words, we will speak of Jesus in the Old Testament and salvation. We will also continue to show the extraordinary prophetic relationship between Joseph's life and Jesus' ministry. And as you mentioned, Daniel, about Jesus prophesied in the Old Testament and salvation, this is the exact purpose of God since the Old Testament, which is to prophetically point out Jesus, who was revealed afterwards in the New Testament. Joseph, in whatever he did not sin and pleased God, is a prophetic and noble figure of the Lord Jesus in the Old Testament. Last week, we showed a table prophetically comparing Jesus and Joseph. A table comparing both of these figures. What is important here to note is that in Joseph, we see the historic aspect. And in Jesus, we see the fulfillment of the prophetic aspect. And one lived centuries after the other. How amazing this is. Joseph was loved by his father, for example. Jesus, on the other hand, was loved by God. Joseph, at 30 years old, started his reign in the land of Egypt. Jesus, at the same age, started his ministry. There is always a prophetic relationship. Joseph was rejected by his brothers. Jesus was also always rejected by the people of Israel, especially the religious people. Joseph was sold by 20 coins of silver. On the other hand, Jesus was sold by 30 coins of silver. And we explained this difference in detail two programs ago. But shall we summarize it again, Daniel? Yes, this difference is very important for us to understand. Why 20 coins of silver and 30 coins of silver? Why is there a difference? Because Joseph went through prison and suffering, but in the end, he lived. The Lord Jesus, on the contrary, paid the full price: suffering, prison, and death. Joseph left prison to become the governor in Egypt. Jesus, on the other hand, resuscitated to stand at the right hand of God our Father. Joseph received in Egypt the name of Zaphenat-Paneah, which means the Savior of the world. He was the Savior of the people in that specific time. Jesus, on the other hand, is the Savior of men today. Joseph wept and forgave his brothers. Jesus did the same thing when he was the cross of Calvary. He said, "Father, forgive them, those who condemned him, for they do not know what they are doing." In our last program, as a result of a lie, Joseph was sent to prison in Egypt. 2 years passed, and then Joseph was still in prison. But then there was an incident in which Pharaoh had a dream which no one could explain. And then at that moment, Joseph was called to the presence of Pharaoh to explain the dream. He then interpreted the dream. He was in prison, but he was called to interpret the dream through the revelation of the Holy Spirit. And then he was taken out of prison and put as the governor of Egypt. After that, in other words, after Joseph was put as the governor of Egypt, Pharaoh did that because he saw that the Holy Spirit of God was in Joseph's life. Joseph, as the governor of Egypt, during 7 years of abundance of food, he gathered enough sustain for the following 7 years of hunger. In those years of hunger, the land of Egypt, because of the orientation of Joseph and his government, they had enough food and became then a point of refuge for even the other surrounding nations. They would all go to Egypt to buy food. And then Joseph was the governor of Egypt. During that time, the people of Canaan, where Joseph's family was from, where they all lived, they also had to go to Egypt to buy their sustain. In that occasion, Joseph saw his brothers and recognized him, although they did not know that the governor of Egypt was in fact Joseph. And there was the encounter of Joseph with his brothers, although Joseph had not revealed himself yet. At that moment occurred the fulfillment of Joseph's dreams when he was still a young man, dreams that were prophetically showing that his brothers would bow down before Joseph. However, Joseph demanded that Simeon, one of his 11 brothers, stayed in Egypt as a guarantee so that his other brothers could go back to Canaan and bring their youngest brother, Benjamin. Before they departed, however, Joseph ordered that the money used by his brothers to buy food should be returned to them without them knowing. That money was then put in their bags of wheat. And Joseph oriented his servants to give them food for their journey back. On their way back home, one of his brothers realized that the money was in their bags and they could not understand how. And then he said, "They returned our money. What has God done to us?" It is interesting to note here that despite their mistakes, all of the mistakes that they had made in the past, they recognized God's intervention. They thought God must be doing something. So in other words, the wheat they had was given for free. That's exactly what happened. And what is the prophetic aspect in this? The wheat was free for them. The prophetic aspect, Sergio, and everyone who's watching us, is that man does not have to pay for his salvation. It is not attained by deeds. Salvation is attained by the grace of God. Jesus has already paid a high and sufficient price, as it is registered in the Word of God in the first letter of Timothy, chapter 2, verse 6. Who gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. This is speaking of the Lord Jesus. He gave himself completely. It is a price that none of us could pay. This price has already been paid. What does man then need to do in order to have the right to this salvation, this blessing? He needs to believe and accept the gift, the grace of God, which is salvation. Now we'll continue to talk about the return of Joseph's brothers to the land of Canaan. When they arrived in Canaan, Joseph's brothers told everything to their father Jacob, who initially did not allow them to take their youngest brother Benjamin to Egypt. However, after some time, when their sustain was gone and while there was still hunger over their land, as pointed out in Pharaoh's dreams that were interpreted by Joseph, Jacob then told their sons that they would have to go back to Egypt to buy more food without taking their youngest brother, Benjamin, Jacob's youngest son, Benjamin. However, his sons told him that the governor of Egypt, who was Joseph, a fact not known by them, would only accept them if they took their youngest brother, Benjamin. Jacob's sons then promised him that they would bring Benjamin back, and then their father allowed them to take him. What is interesting here is that demand from Joseph. He said, "You will only be accepted if you bring Benjamin back with you." In other words, he said, "I only accept your presence here with me if you have your youngest brother Benjamin." So much so that Joseph demanded Simeon to stay there with him as a guarantee of that promise. Why did Joseph demand that? Why was there such a demand? We know that everything in the Word of God has a prophetic context. In fact, that demand from Joseph has a special prophetic meaning. In order for him to reveal himself to his brothers, it was essential, it was fundamental for Benjamin to be present. In the same way, happens in the project of salvation. In order for Jesus to reveal himself to man, to the sinner, the presence of the Holy Spirit is essential, Sergio. The experience of a new birth is fundamental. It is the experience of a regenerated life, a new life in Jesus. Joseph's brothers then arrived at Joseph's presence a second time. As soon as they arrived, when Joseph saw his brother Benjamin, he ordered them all to go to his house for a banquet. His brothers were initially scared on that second encounter with Joseph. They asked themselves, "Why do we have to go to the governor's house? Is that because of the money that was found in our bags?" That would actually be a heavy sentence, because they had lives that were marked by mistakes. Then it was time for them to go to the banquet. But before Simeon, their brother that had stayed behind, gathered with them, he was released. When that happened, in other words, when the 11 brothers were introduced to Joseph's presence, he asked them a question. "What about your father, Jacob? How is he doing? Is he still alive?" In the first encounter that they had with Joseph, they had referred to Jacob, their father, as an old man. What a prophetic question, right? Is your father still alive? And more, when Jacob is mentioned by their sons as an old man, we see here a prophetic aspect. In a certain way, and in many cases actually, man believes that God has become old, that the things of the Lord are no longer current. Man does not understand God's values. He only understands them in his process of conversion. Moreover, he who valued God the Father the most was Jesus, through his sacrifice, through his death at the cross of Calvary. This is the value from God to man. Now I ask you a question. What does man need to do, Daniel, to recognize God's gift to him? What does he have to do in order to recognize God's value to him? The Word of God has a very interesting answer to that question, Sergio. The biblical text says, "What shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits toward me?" That text is found in the book of Psalms, chapter 116. And he continues saying, "I will take up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord." this expression is very interesting, the cup of salvation. Because Jesus himself said that, would I not take the cup that my Father gave me? But in that occasion, it was the cup of death, the cup of obedience, the cup of self-resignation, the cup of love, the cup of humbleness, the cup of his dedication. Salvation is indeed a great blessing, but this cup needs to be drank by faith, by obedience, by dedication, by gratitude to the great and amazing love of God. In other words, it is not sufficient to just accept the love of Jesus and receive a blessing. One also needs to keep walking. There is a dynamic process that accompanies salvation. Many just want a blessing, but many also do not want to take the cup of salvation. After that, Joseph raised his eyes and saw Benjamin and asked, "Is this your youngest brother?" He said. Benjamin was his youngest brother, but he asked, "Is this your youngest brother?" When his brothers were before him, they had to answer two questions. First was, "Does your father still live? Is your father alive?" And then they had to answer, "Is this your youngest brother?" No, beloved, the prophetic relationship between Joseph's life and the Lord Jesus. This is how the salvation of Jesus takes place. There is no salvation without men recognizing that God the Father is alive. Glory to God. There is no salvation if man does not recognize the need for a new birth, prophetically represented by the person of Benjamin, Jacob's youngest son. There is the reason for that question. Is this your youngest brother? This question, Daniel, can actually be posed in a prophetic context to men, or even to us in our days, right? That is right. Have you been born again? Are you a new creature? Is your life transformed in Jesus? Have you accepted Jesus and are you walking with him? Because this is the way and we need to walk in it. And the Bible says the following, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature and the old things have already passed. And everything is new. This is the effect of salvation, a new life in Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of sins. One day, Jesus, in the same way, talked to a man, Sergio. This man was named Nicodemus, a man who was intelligent. He had an important position in his society. He was religious. Jesus talked to him about a new birth, but he could not understand what Jesus was saying because Jesus was speaking of something that is prophetic, that which is spiritual. And Jesus reached the point of telling Nicodemus, he who is not born of the water and the Spirit cannot see the kingdom of God. In other words, there is no salvation, there is no eternal life. But some may ask, what does it mean to be born of water? It represents the action of the Word of God that cleanses and purifies man. What about be born in the Spirit? It represents a new life, guided and governed by the Holy Spirit in sanctification and obedience. Blessed is the name of the Lord. Let us now participate of a song of praise that will be accompanied by beautiful images. I would like to invite you and your family to sing along with us, to praise God, because His praise delivers us, and it makes us rejoice. It calms and comforts our souls.
The same God who took care of me yesterday is alive in my life today. Surely his goodness and mercy will follow me the days of my life. I don't have to be afraid. Jesus Christ will keep me safe. I don't have to be afraid, for he'll guide me in his way. And he'll lead me to the spring of living water. And in heaven, he'll welcome me home. The same God who took care of me yesterday is alive in my life today. Surely his goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. I don't have to be afraid. Jesus Christ will keep me safe. I don't have to be afraid, for he'll guide me in his way.
Glory to Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Amen. Joseph then ordered his servants to fill his brothers' bags with food, to return their money, and to also put in Benjamin's bag, the youngest brother, the silver cup that Joseph used to drink wine. And that's exactly what they did. The banquet was finished, and Joseph's brothers were ready to departure with their bags replenished with food. So they departed, taking their belongings. They were all rejoicing. They were all satisfied. And that actually reminds me of what actually happens to many in our days. Many receive a blessing, and they go on their way. The sinner lives situations like these. Maybe they get a new job offer, or they receive a healing or deliverance from a certain difficult situation, or even a service where they receive a blessing through a prayer, and that's it. And some even say, we have everything. We have a good religion. We don't need this anymore. Let's go on our way. And this reminds me of a passage in the ministry of the Lord Jesus involving some men with leprosy. 10 lepers approached Jesus, who healed all of them. 9 of them went on their way, and only one returned and praised the Lord Jesus. He bowed before the Lord because he understood that it was not just a blessing of healing, 10 received the blessing, but only one valued the blessing of salvation. During his brother's journey back home, Joseph sent one of his servants to reach them and ask them a question, as is registered in the book of Genesis, chapter 44, verse 5. Is not this the one from which my Lord drinks, the silver cup? Then Joseph's servant approached his brothers and inquired them about the silver cup. All of them denied, saying that they were good men who would never steal anything. So they opened their bags to show what was in them. But then the silver cup was found in the bag of the youngest, their youngest brother, Benjamin. What would they do now? All of their previous denials, their arguments, all of those arguments had a prophetic meaning. And what happens is that many today use the same arguments. I am a good person. I don't get in anyone's way. I wish everyone the best. I don't need God. But we know that a soul without God is an empty soul. It is an empty soul. Now, returning to the story, what Joseph's brothers did not know was that in that silver cup, there was an experience provided by God. The silver cup prophetically represents the experience with the Holy Spirit, the deposit of salvation. Man can even distance himself from God, like Joseph's brothers did, but the silver cup is within him. The silver is a symbol of redemption, of the price that Jesus paid on the cross in favor of men, in favor of the sinner. When Paul wrote the letter to the Ephesians, he spoke about the redemption through the blood of Jesus. And he said, "In Jesus we have the redemption through his blood, the remission of our offenses, through the riches of his grace." It is interesting to note, Sergio, that the silver cup was used by Joseph to drink his wine and for him to rejoice. And prophetically speaking, in order for man to participate of the joy of salvation, he needs the redemption, which is symbolized by the silver. Therefore, the silver cup is the deposit of this salvation. It means that we have to drink of the blessing that Jesus puts at our disposal. The Word of God says, "For by grace you have been saved, through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God." The 11 brothers then had to return to Egypt to meet Joseph again. When they arrived in Egypt, one of the brothers, Judah, said, "What shall we say to our Lord? What shall we say? We are slaves of our Lord, us and he in whose bag the silver cup was found." He was speaking of Benjamin, the youngest. He who was promised to be taken back to his father Jacob, for his brothers had said, "We will take Benjamin, but we'll bring him back." Judah even told Joseph, "If we go back to our father without our youngest brother, our father will die." The conversation went on, and Joseph could no longer hold back his tears. He asked everyone to leave him and his brothers alone in the room. And the Word of God says that he cried in such a way that the Egyptians could even hear him. It was at that moment that Joseph finally said, "I am Joseph." This expression is the same one from Jesus to man. The revelation of Joseph to his brothers was a prophecy of salvation through Jesus, of how Jesus reveals himself to men. of how he wants to reveal himself to men. There was a man in the past, Paul, who persecuted the church, but one day Jesus revealed himself to him. Paul then saw a great light and heard a voice that called him by his name. When Paul asked, "Who are you, Lord?" then an answer came, "I am Jesus." Just like how Joseph had said, "I am Joseph," many centuries after the prophecy was fulfilled, and it continues to be fulfilled in our days when the Lord reveals himself to men. He wants to reveal himself to many for an experience of salvation, of forgiveness, of reconciliation, and fellowship with him. When someone meets Jesus in a service, or maybe in a visit, maybe a presential service, the first expectation that the many have is that the Lord will condemn them for their sins, that he'll point out his mistakes. But that's not what happens. The Lord Jesus forgives before anything. He blesses us. He extends his hands to us. He manifests himself with his love. Note that Joseph did not ask anything from his brothers. Joseph forgave them. And now we can leave some questions to you who are watching us today. How are you today? What is the situation in your life today? What is your sin? Come to Jesus. Confess. Ask for help. And he will extend his hands to you. What is interesting here, Sergio, is that Joseph, when he forgave his brothers, he did not impose any conditions to forgive them. He did not say, "I'll forgive you if you do this for me." No, he simply forgave them. Forgiveness is forgiveness. And there he prophesied about God's forgiveness. The word of God says, "I will not remember your sins anymore." This is God's forgiveness. In other words, all we have to do is to accept Jesus. So open your heart, accept Jesus, and start walking in his presence. Joseph then told his brothers, "Now you will go back to Canaan and bring to Egypt my father Jacob. You will bring to me, to my presence, my father Jacob. I want my whole family with me." So we see the story that we're concluding now. Three prophetic figures that point to the Trinity. The Trinity is prophesied here. It is the perfect reunion of salvation. Glory to God. The Trinity is here prophesied. Joseph, as the son, prophetically speaks of Jesus. Jacob, the father, represents God, the Father. And Benjamin, the youngest, points out to the Holy Spirit because he symbolizes the new birth. Because he who gives men the condition to a new birth, he who acts for the new birth of man is the Holy Spirit. Glory to the name of the Lord. The right that his brothers had to forgiveness, Joseph's brothers, the right to reconciliation and to the communion with Joseph, only happened because, pay attention to this, because of Benjamin, the youngest brother. As we previously saw, Benjamin represents the Holy Spirit. And the Bible says that the Holy Spirit is the one who intercedes for you, for us, for you and me, with inexpressible groanings. It is necessary for us to be born again. Not in a static way, no. but to be born again every day in Jesus. It is a process of growth and knowledge of God through the faith in Jesus and in sanctification of the Holy Spirit. We showed here the extraordinary story of Joseph. However, beloved, the most important part in this story is what is prophetic. That's what's most notable here. Especially when it becomes clear how the project of salvation works in man's life. Something that is prophesied since the Old Testament. Maranatha, the Lord Jesus will come. Glory to God. There is an interaction between the sketch lessons of Manaim and the Sunday Bible School of the Maranatha Christian Church, which takes place every Sunday at 10 a.m. Brazilian time, 9 a.m. Eastern time, through our YouTube channel, when we give continuity to the doctrinary content that has been taught. We invite you to continue to watch the program announcing the eternal gospel with the sketches to follow. The peace of the Lord Jesus. The peace of the Lord Jesus to everyone. In the sketch Perfect Praise today, the teacher Janaína will continue to teach how to play the melodica. So get your instrument and let's learn.
Peace of the Lord to everyone, especially the children, intermediates, and adolescents. Have you guys been practicing? We are seeing that you are, because we have received many videos and testimonials, not only playing the recorder and the melodica, but many other instruments. Praise the name of the Lord. So let's watch. On the recorder, Deborah Beatriz, she's 7 years old, from the city of Teresina in the state of Piauí. On the keyboard, Julia, she's also 7 years old. She's from Cabo Frio in Rio de Janeiro. On the melodica, Emmanuel, 9 years old, from Teixeira de Freitas, state of Bahia. On the guitar, Julia Brives de Oliveira, the city of Piabetá, Magé, in the state of Rio de Janeiro. On the rattle, we have little Davi Longo playing alongside his sister Isabela Bueno. They're from the city of Ceres. Also on the melodica, we have Stephanie from the church in the Monica Cristina neighborhood in the city of Uberaba, the state of Minas Gerais. This is little Samuel, 2 years old, with his recorder. Even though he only has a small part of the recorder, because what's important is for the children to be stimulated in the praise of the name of the Lord. Wonderful! Keep practicing and sending us your videos and testimonials. Last class, we learned the easier version of the introduction of the song, Lord, Your Beauty Fills Me With Amazement. But we did not mention what we would learn today. Do you guys know? In the middle of the song, there's an instrumental part before we go back to the chorus. And that is what we're going to learn today. We have already learned the position of the notes on the keyboard of the melodica. It has 2 octaves. The first octave is lower pitched from do to do. And the second octave is higher pitched from do to do. We will use these notes but both in the first and second octaves. Now I will explain the facilitated version of the sheet music. We are on a quaternary compass, which means 4 tempos for each compass. Then we'll have the 8th note break that is worth half a tempo. We also have the arrows to help us remember how it will stretch to put our finger on the right place. Also, on the second part, we will work with both octaves. this arrow will help us. From the lower pitch Do to the higher pitch Do. Now, let's read the notes and I will explain. Sol, Sol, La, Ti, Do, Ti, La, Ti. Stretch. Mi, 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 Fa, Sol, La, Sol, Fa, Sol. Stretch. Do, Do. Now an octave higher. Do, Re, Mi, Re, Do, La, Do. Do. Stretch. Sol, La, Ti. Now I will show you on the melodica without sound. Sol, Sol, La, Ti, Do, Ti, La, Ti. Stretch. Mi, 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 Fa, Sol, La, Sol, Fa, Sol. Stretch. Do, Do. Now an octave higher. Do, Re, Mi, Re, Do, La, Do, Do. Stretch. Sol, La, Ti. So let's count so we can play together. 1, 2, 3, 4. To play along with the song, we have to play faster. Let's count. 1, 2, 3, 4. Practicing. Amen. Now I want to invite all of you to grab your instruments so that we can play and sing this song. Peace of the Lord Jesus, and until next class.
Eu posso.
In the sketch specially prepared for the children, intermediates, and adolescents, we are learning about the story of Joseph. And today, with the teacher Andrea Talma, we will learn about the encounter between Joseph and his brothers.
I'd like to greet the children and adolescents with the peace of the Lord Jesus. The theme of our class today is the encounter of Joseph with his brothers. We will read in Genesis chapter 45, verse 4. Let's read. And Joseph said to his brothers, "Please come near to me." So they came near. Then he said, "I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into Egypt." We are learning about the story of Joseph. Joseph was sold by his brothers. He was a slave in Egypt, but God honored his life. Joseph became the governor of Egypt. And after, there were 7 years of famine over the earth, a great hunger, and only in Egypt there was food. Famine also reached Jacob's house, Joseph's father. So Jacob sent his sons to fetch food in Egypt. But Jacob did not send Benjamin, because Benjamin was his youngest son, whom he loved very much. He had already lost Joseph. Jacob did not want to lose Benjamin as well. So Benjamin stayed, and his 10 brothers went. When they reached Egypt, they were marveled at the abundance of food. "Look how much food they had here. Look over there." So Joseph's brothers kneeled down before the governor, who was Joseph, but they did not know that it was Joseph who was the governor. But Joseph, when he saw his brothers, he immediately recognized them. They went back to Canaan, told their father everything that had happened, but after a while their food supply had run out and they had to go back to Egypt to buy more. And at that moment they brought Benjamin along with them. When Joseph saw Benjamin, his heart was filled with happiness and peace. It was a marvelous moment. Joseph prepared a banquet and had a feast with his families, his brothers. But he still had not revealed himself to them. So they left to go back home. Everyone had their own bag full of food. But in that moment, a servant went after Joseph's brothers and found a silver cup in Benjamin's food supply bag. So they had to return. When they got to Joseph's house, in that moment, Joseph revealed himself to his brothers. In that moment where he was together with his brothers, Benjamin and the silver cup, Joseph said, "I am Joseph." And in this part of the story, we see Joseph typifying the Lord Jesus, because Jesus also wants to reveal himself to us. Jesus is saying, "I am Jesus. I want to save you." And for Jesus to reveal himself to you, he has to send his Holy Spirit for us. It's the Holy Spirit that reveals Jesus to us. Jesus gives us the cup of salvation. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. In this marvelous encounter, Joseph hugged and kissed his brothers. He cried a lot. It was a marvelous moment. And his brothers became sad, saying, "But we sold you, Joseph." And Joseph told them, "Don't be sad. Everything that happened was in God's project, so that today you may have life and I may sustain you." And Joseph sustained his father, his brothers. They went to live with him. And in this story, we see a great teaching for us. Jesus wants to reveal himself to us. He wants to reveal himself to you. He is saying, "Come near to me." But how can we be close to Jesus? By going to church. Look at the children here. It's when we are praying, adolescents. It's when we're reading the Bible. That way we are close to Jesus. It's not the time to distance ourselves from him, but it's the moment to be very close to Jesus, because Jesus wants to give you salvation, the eternal life, and to everyone the peace of the Lord.
I can do all things through Christ.
Have you been touched by the message announced in this program? Would you like to get to know the Maranatha Christian Church? Maybe you haven't had a true experience with God yet and need a prayer or even an assistance. If that's the case, you may call us at any moment through this number, 0800-707-3076. This is an exclusive number to assist those who are not yet members of the Maranatha Christian Church and need a word from the Lord or even a prayer. You can call this number from any part of Brazil, 7 days a week, 20 hours per day, 24 hours per day, and someone will assist you. And don't forget to access our YouTube channel to like and share the materials posted there, to share the links of the services to evangelize. This program, for example, is found there and you can watch as many times as you want. Also, follow us on Instagram and on Facebook and see the Maranatha Christian Church materials posted there. Also, access the website of the Maranatha Christian Church and the Manaí radio station. Download the free apps and take a moment to experiment them and get to know more about us and about our digital platforms. Through the Manaí radio station app, you can listen to the radio 24 hours per day, and you can even download and share the podcasts of services and messages found there. And now we have come to the end of this edition of the program Announcing the Eternal Gospel from the Maranatha Christian Church. And I would like to remind you that every Sunday at 10 a.m. Brazilian time, 9 a.m. Eastern time, you can watch our Sunday Bible School in our YouTube channel. Next week, if the Lord permits, we'll be here again with another edition of the program Announcing the Eternal Gospel by the Maranatha Christian Church. Maranatha, the Lord Jesus will come. Thank you.